All right. So, Boost Generic. I'm not sure how many people actually know what Boost Generic is. I mean, currently, I think the only thing I've mentioned about it has been on the mailing list about back in December or so. But basically, the whole idea of the library Boost Generic is it's an attempt to emulate as much as I can of the postponed C++ OX concept features, just all through preprocessor metaprogramming and macro invocations. So, brief overview of what I'm going to go through. Just a refresher on what generic programming actually is. Then I'll go through exactly what happened to concepts and why they're no longer in the standard. We'll go over substitution failure is not an error. I think most of you already know what this is. There have been some changes in the new standard that impact the development of this library that I think are very interesting, so I'll go over that. Then I'll go into a brief history of Boost Generic. This just explains how I came to develop the actual library. It's actually kind of an interesting narrative. Then I'll go through all of the necessary tools that it took to get to this point. There's a lot of kind of strange tricks that involve C++ OX features that are used in odd ways. And then finally, we'll actually get into the concepts. We'll start out with some basic concepts and asserts. Then I'll go into how you actually create your own concepts and create your own concept maps. And then we'll end with future direction on where I would like the library to go. Okay, so you tell me, what is generic programming? I'm kind of curious as to how much people actually know about generic programming and what it actually is. So if anybody has anything to say, I mean, bring it up. I'm only looking for a few keywords. So you can just shout them out. Static polymorphism. Okay. It's not one of the things I was looking for, but anything else?
Compile time.
What was that?
Compile time.
Compile time? Okay. Yeah. Again, not exactly something I was looking for.
Concept based.
All right. Okay. That's one of the things that I'm looking for is concepts. Okay.
Concepts and algorithms are separated.
Right. Okay. Good.
Type parameterization.
Okay. Well, you're getting there. So I'll just... Here are the things I was looking for. Obviously, it's a programming paradigm, right? It was developed by Alexander Sepinov and David Musser. It's the paradigm that's used in the standard template library, Boost Graph library, the generic image library, and many others. It's algorithm-centric. So essentially what happens is you start with a bunch of separate concrete algorithms, as opposed to the OOP approach of generally starting with objects, right? You start with algorithms, and then from the separate implementations of similar algorithms on different types, you go through a process called lifting. And the idea of lifting is you look at all the similarities between different algorithms and you abstract away all of the differences. And from that, you're able to produce a set of requirements or constraints on your types and produce a generic algorithm. This multi-sorted algebras, this is how Stepanov tends to refer to concepts. And what it means is essentially, concepts are acting upon multiple types at once, right? So when you're working in object-oriented programming, you generally get your polymorphism via interfaces or abstract-based classes. Yet, concepts, on the other hand, operate on multiple types at once. In particular, you can think of the iterator types, right? We have several iterator concepts, and not only do they have certain associated function and a requirement set on them, they also have associated types, which in turn have separate constraints. There's also refinement, obviously. For instance, random access iterator is a refinement of bidirectional iterator. All that means is that it has all of the same requirements and constraints with additional ones added. Concept mapping is something that can happen automatically or explicitly, and it basically specifies how a given type maps onto a given concept. Next, we have archetypes, which is basically the minimum conforming data type that meets all of the requirements of a given concept. And now that's very important for specifically when you're writing an algorithm. You have certain constraints set on that, on the parameter types of that algorithm. And what you want to do is be able to be sure that when you write the algorithm, you're not using any functionality that is beyond the constraints that you specified, right? So for instance, if your constraint was that, was only that the type being passed was default constructible or something along those lines, if you internally try to copy the parameter, you did not say that you were requiring a copy constructible requirement, so it should, you know, spit up an error when you're trying to create that algorithm. And that's
importantly at the point of definition of the algorithm.
Right, of course, and that's true. At the point that you write the algorithm, not when you're actually instantiating the algorithm. And then next we have concept-based overloading, which is essentially just saying that for a given algorithm, you can not only just overload based on the actual types you're passing, but on the different constraints that they meet. So an example of that is split advance, which is overloaded for, I think, input iterators, bidirectional iterators, and random access iterators. So the random access iterator obvious version advances in constant time, whereas the other ones have to advance in linear time. But it'll automatically detect everything. And the way that's actually simulated in the standard library currently, because we don't have concepts, is via tag dispatching, which I hope everybody is somewhat familiar with. OK. So the end of C++X concepts. So I'm not sure how many people are actually familiar with why concepts were actually removed from the standard. But essentially, there were two philosophies behind how concepts should work in the standard. And specifically, there was the Indiana proposal, which was under the impression that concepts should be explicit. And by that, I mean that it wasn't enough that you'd specify a concept that had associated type and associated function requirements. You had to also occasionally, for certain concepts, explicitly specify that you model this particular concept, right? So for instance, if you have a concept that says it has an associated function, the increment operator, it's not enough just that you have the increment operator. You also have to specify explicitly, hey, I do model this concept. And then in addition to that, it also has to check for constraints. It also allows for auto concepts, which are the opposite of that. If you meet all of the associated function requirements and associated type requirements, then you are automatically considered modeling that concept. And then the last thing is concept maps. So you have, again, this goes back to explicitly modeling the concept. That's how you specify explicitly all of the associated types and associated functions that correspond with your data type that map it to the concept. Now, on the other hand, there was the Texas proposal, and they took a different approach. Particularly, I think Bjarne was he looked at explicit concept maps as being a sort of like a code smell. Like, it seemed that it was, he was expecting that there would be too many pieces of code where there would be completely empty explicit concept maps, correct? So in other words, you'd have, I'm trying to think of, does anybody know?
So the thinking was you would have something that completely modeled, had all of the complicated syntactic requirements to model a concept. And still, he thought that it would be very burdensome if you had to write a concept map, especially an empty one, that didn't add any particular behavior or anything to declare that a given type models that concept, mm-hmm. even though you fulfilled all the syntactic requirements.
Right. So in other words, even though everything meets the syntactic requirements, it shouldn't be required that you just put in an empty concept map, because that's just, to him, it seemed redundant. So there were only automatic concepts, which were basically the auto concepts from the Indiana proposal, and there were no explicit concept maps. Now, without going too much into like a political kind of thing, I side with the Indiana proposal for reasons I won't go into, but we could talk about that later.
To be perfectly fair, also to the process, mm-hmm. there was broad agreement, including among Bjarne and Gabby, that we were going to have explicit concepts, concept maps and everything. And just sort of toward the end, it's like Bjarne had a freak out and decided that it was not going to work and everybody was going to be upset with it.
Right. But, so. Okay. So substitution failure is not an error. Okay. So So I'm not sure how many people are familiar with SVNA. I think most people are. But essentially, the whole concept of SVNA is that when you're going through, when you're substituting your deduced parameters, your template parameters, if you produce a type in either the return type or the parameter types that cannot be evaluated, for instance, in this example, type name f colon colon result type, if you try to call negate with an integer, right, and you substitute int for f, you don't want that to actually produce an error, right? You want it to just ignore that overload from the set when it's determining which overload is called, right? So in the bottom line, we're calling negate with the literal one, and we want to make sure that there's no error that happens simply by considering the second negate function template. We want it to just pick the first one, have no error whatsoever, and everything works out fine. So does anybody have any questions on that? I think that's pretty clear, right? Okay. So Boost has this little facility called enable if, and it basically exploits this whole concept in a way that it takes a Boolean condition, and depending on whether that Boolean condition is satisfied, it defines a nested type. And if it's not defined, then there's no type at all. And so we use that when working with function definitions or type template definitions in order to enable and disable particular overloads depending on whether they satisfy a given condition. So for instance, in this particular case, I realize I have a typo there that should be enable if underscore c.
Or you could just drop the colon on the inside.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I only did that because I didn't want to show all of the definitions. So it's just enabling the first foo if there's a trivial destructor for the type that you're passing, and it disables it if there's not. So this is very useful because oftentimes you may wish to optimize your code based on whether or not a given condition is satisfied, in this case particularly if it has a trivial destructor or not. So that's the general idea of substitution failures, not an error. The new changes that have happened in OX, which are the fundamental changes that allow me to implement this library, are that, one, that it's been expanded to apply to any arbitrary or nearly arbitrary expressions that appear in either the parameter list or the return type. So for instance, if I tried to do an add operation and it appeared somewhere in the return type, and that was not valid for the given types that I'm using, that would also, in effect, cause substitution failures and an error to trigger, and that particular overload would be ignored. And the second change that had been made is that SVNA is now aware of access. So for instance, if in that enable if template, if I had put a private before typedef t type in O3, C++ O3, what would happen is even though type is not accessible, because it's private, you would actually get an access error because type is defined, but it is not accessible. So that the change that was made in C++ OX is that if it's private, you just ignore the overload just as you would with any other type of SVNA. So okay, here we go. So how I actually got started with Boost.Generic. The subtitle, or how I learned to stop worrying and love the preprocessor, is because this is essentially one gigantic macro hack. So the whole idea is I wanted to create a macro that allowed me to specify concepts in a way that was extremely similar to the way that they were specified in the C++ OX standard. And in order to do that, it's actually very complicated because if anybody's familiar with how the preprocessor works, you're very limited in terms of what you can do, right? You can expand macros, you can concatenate tokens together, and you can stringize arguments, and that's pretty much it, right? There's no recursion, there's no anything. So here's how I actually got started. It all began with OX auto functions. So I encountered this problem, right? And I think everybody who's familiar with auto functions knows the answer to this, but you're defining operator minus, and you're just having it work on any arbitrary types. This is nested in some kind of namespace or something. And you want to determine what the return type would be of this operation. So the question is, how do you determine that? You're working on arbitrary types. What you really want to say is, automatically deduce the type from what the return type expression is, right? And so OX introduced this new feature called auto functions, or it's actually the trailing return type syntax for function declarations. And what it does is it allows you to specify the return type of a function after the parameter list. And this allows you to put the parameters, or actually use the parameter names when determining the result type. And so this allows us to put the actual expression that goes in the return type into the return type, and then you don't have to worry about doing any strange sort of meta function resolution in order to figure out the return type. But the problem is this is very redundant, right? We're kind of repeating the expression in two different places. Kind of goofy. I mean, when I first heard about auto functions, I sort of had it in my mind that the return type would be automatically deduced, right? Why do we have to repeat things? And what's kind of strange is, in the more complicated case, when dealing with OX lambda functions, this behavior actually already exists. When you're working with lambda functions in OX, if you do not specify a return type and you have a one-line function, it will automatically do exactly what we're doing in the above case, except without having to have any redundancy at all.
But you have to declare your argument.
Right. Well, and the reason why there are no, you mean the LNR, right? Yeah, so this is nested, of course, in some kind of template. The reason why is it's not exactly similar to the above example is because you cannot template lambda expressions. They're not polymorphic. Okay, so I created this macro called boost auto function. It's in the sandbox. And all it did was repeat the expression that appears in the lower part. That's not a typo there. There is not a semicolon there because that's actually a macro argument. And it repeats that expression in both the return type and the expression. And so the whole idea was, okay, now all of a sudden there's no redundancy and I get exactly what I had in the previous slide. But I ran into a problem, and that was, how do I use enable if in this particular case, right? So usually when you use enable if, you use it in either the parameter types or the return type, and in either case, we cannot do that here, right? Because first of all, we do not have an explicit return type, so there's no place to put it there. And also, we're passing in the arguments, and they're being deduced, so we cannot use enable if as an argument or an additional argument because it's an overloaded operator and it can only be two arguments there. So my answer to this was to just add more arguments to my macro. And all I did was I created this syntax for passing in arbitrary meta function conditions, right? And internally what it does is it uses enable if. And right now, if you examine this code, what it does is this is a hypothetical. It says is vector UDT, so just some user-defined vector type. If both of the operations are some user-defined vector type, then we want to enable this function overload. Otherwise, it's disabled via VNet. And then I started to think, okay, well, if we can do this, then can we apply this similar type of thing to take advantage of the new extensions of VNet? For instance, working with arbitrary expressions that we want to enable or disable based on. Okay, so I added even more named parameters, right? So what I did was I added this sort of try argument, right? And I try LHS plus RHS and negative RHS, and if those are valid expressions, then I enable this function overload. And also, if type name, this is just showing off the feature. If there's some kind of nested type called value type, then that's also another condition that's required. And it's, you know, anyway, the point is you're able to do a lot with VNet. But ultimately, you know, this is all in the wrong place, right? What we really want to do is we want to come up with a way to represent concepts. So.
I'm sorry, can I interrupt for just a second?
Yeah, sure.
This is really cool already.
Right,
this
but
is
it's
really, really cool.
Okay.
Even if it's in the wrong place.
Yeah.
It's really cool.
Yeah. Okay. Cool. Glad you think so. So, at this point, I was saying, okay, it's in the wrong place, right? We wanted to find concepts. So, what if I take these ideas and instead of applying them to function overloads directly. What if I made a facility for creating something like OX concepts and then enable based on that? You know, make it so that way I could generate some type of meta function via this preprocessor metaprogramming, and have it so that way I could check it and get sort of a true or false value from that to see if it actually models the concept. So this is the equality comparable concept definition that was in O3. It's very different from what it looks like in OX, but this is what I was using as in my first iteration of the library to try to come up with some type of idea on how I could generate this macro. So it reads, in these tables, and these tables refers to both equality comparable and other concepts that are defined in that section. I think there's less than comparable, blah, 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 blah. So in these tables, T is an object or reference type to be supplied by a C++ program instantiating a template. A, B, and C are value type, possibly const T. So what that means is that we have these givens, A, B, and C, of type T. So given those givens, we need to have a valid expression, A equals equals B. That the return type of that expression has to be convertible to bool. And then the last requirement are essentially our axioms. So it says equals equals is an equivalence relation. That is, it has the following properties. For all A equals A, which is just reflexivity. A equals B, then B equals A, which is symmetry. And A equals B, B equals C, then A equals C, that's transitivity. And so I looked at all of these different requirements and I said, okay, what are the basics I need out of a macro in order to represent these requirements? And this is the first iteration of the macro, and this is what it looked like, right? So it was originally not called ad hoc concept. I've kind of deprecated it, and that's why it has that name now. So I declare a name. That's the parameter type list. So it operates on one type, T, which, if you remember from earlier, T is the object that we're checking if it's equality comparable. That 4 right there is how I specify givens. So for T const A and T const B, try A equals B. So does that operation exist? And is the result of that operation convertible to bool, right? And so what this generates behind the scenes is it's not exactly a meta function. It's a type that contains many meta functions. And the idea is, if I want to check if something is equality comparable, I can check each of these conditions individually. And depending on which ones are or are not satisfied, I can give a static assert and tell you specifically what you did wrong. So for instance, in this case, if you provided an A equals equals B operation for some arbitrary type that you created, and it did not have a result type convertible to bool, and you checked via another macro if it modeled the concept equality comparable, it would tell you explicitly, it would have a static assert that just says, error, it is not convertible from decal type A equals equals B, comma, bool. And so that was the first iteration of the library. And I was extremely enthusiastic about this. I posted it to the mailing list, and I was like, hey, everybody check this out. And there was general positive response. And then, of course, Dave said, wait, this is all well and good, but why don't you just follow the same kind of approach that the OX concepts proposal did? And that is have pseudo-signatures, right? So in the OX concept proposal, instead of specifying these kind of arbitrary expressions and meta-function conditions, what you do is you say, I have an associated type and an associated function that must match the signature. And it's kind of a loose match. It says that the return type that's specified in the pseudo-signature must, you know, be convertible from the type that you are returning, and it specifies all the arguments that must be required. So I said, you know what? About 2 months later, I realized that, you know, Dave is ultimately completely correct. There are other reasons why I decided to go along with the pseudo-signature approach, and that is that I could automatically generate archetypes. And so about 2 months after that, which is, I think, February or March, I decided to scrap this approach, and I decided to implement pseudo-signatures. And so before I did that, I decided, okay, I'm going to take a step back and see exactly what can be accomplished, like exactly how many features from the OX proposal can I start emulating here. And so these were my overall goals. First of all, obviously, I wanted to represent concepts as closely as possible. N2914 is the last working paper that had concepts in them, so I was using that as a reference. support the major features of concepts. So I wanted to do pseudo-signatures, associated templates, associated types, constraints on associated types, and so on. I wanted to keep the error messages simple, in particular even simpler than the Boost concept check library. I wanted to automatically generate archetypes, so that way when you write your algorithms, you can test them with archetypes that it automatically generates. I wanted to support concept overloading, which is the big feature, which is what we were using tag dispatch to simulate for STD Advanced. I wanted to allow a choice of backends. This one's kind of interesting. So because I was planning on making a macro that was able to take in these things that look very much like the OX concepts proposal, I should, in theory, be able to output via macro invocations not only this sort of emulated concept, but also the actual code that is equivalent in terms of the OX proposal. And the reason why that's important is because there's concept GCC, which is now somewhat dead, but there's also concept Clang, which is actively under development. And so if I can output directly the standard concept code, then on compilers which support the concepts as an extension, I would be able to directly support them there rather than emulating. So that's a huge goal. And the other thing was I wanted to minimize the pain inflicted on compilers. Just kidding.
Did you succeed with that last one?
I did not. That's why there's the just kidding.
Well, now, are you distinguishing between the preprocessor and the compiler?
I'm inflicting pain on both. So, in fact, much more on the preprocessor, as it turns out. Okay, so this is an example from N2914 of how arithmetic-like is defined. And so I use this as sort of a base reference of what syntax can I possibly get out of this in a macro form. And so just briefly, in case you're not familiar, this specifies a non-auto concept called arithmetic-like that operates on one parameter t. It's a refinement of regular type, which means that it's copyable, it's equality comparable, default constructible, destructible, etc. It's also a refinement of less than comparable. It has a unary plus operation, has negate, dot, 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 dot. There's actually something like 10 or 15 other things that it refines. It's a fairly complicated concept. Those are that follow are the associated function requirements. Here they're explicit constructors. So you have to be constructible from the largest integral types, both signed and unsigned, and also from the largest floating point type. And then we have some requires conditions. So we require that the result type of the unary plus operation, for instance, is convertible to the original type t that we're operating on, right? And there's actually like 20 more related requires clauses for the other associated operations. So this was the original hypothetical macro syntax, and this is actually what ended up being put into the library. There are actually more iterations before I settled in on this syntax, but it looks pretty similar, right? So I'm not going to go line by line on this. I'll explain in detail later on exactly how this works and which lines are associated with which. But I think here you can at least see the similarities. So, I put together a list of exactly what I thought I could accomplish so far. So, associated types, I already know I can check. We know that Sphene is capable of checking if certain types are present, right? Associated functions, similarly, we can check arbitrary expressions via Sphene now. So that's also a yes. Multi-type concepts, I didn't show an example of that, but it's fairly obvious that, you know, if we look at the previous slide, I could just tack on an extra type and nothing else about how I deduce anything, like requires there to be only one type there. So multi-type concepts seem to be pretty reasonable. Concept maps, these are implemented just simply as template specializations. So for instance, you can pass in a given concept name and all of its associated parameters that you're checking if it complies to that concept. And if you have a concept map defined, then that's the specialization that's picked. So concept maps seemed like at this point that they could be supported, which they are. Archetypes, I already established that I could generate based on pseudo-signatures. That feature is not implemented yet, but get into that. So actually, wait. So concept refinement is actually a sort of difficult problem. And the reason why concept refinement is so difficult is because, according to the standard, if you have a hierarchy of concepts, for instance, the iterator concepts that we're all familiar with, if you define an explicit concept map for a random access iterator, you want that concept map to act as the map for the bidirectional iterator that it is a refinement of, and also a forward iterator, input iterator, etc., without having to manually make a concept map for each one of the ones along the way. So in order to do that, the way it's defined in the standard, or in the last proposal that had, or the last working paper that had concepts, was it said when you are checking for the concept map in the less refined concept, what you do is you have a list of all of the more refined concepts, and you first, or second, after you check if there's one directly, you go through a list of all of the more refined concepts that you know of in that translation unit, and you try to do some kind of match to see if a concept map exists for those. So the difficult problem here is, and if I want to emulate that functionality, what I need to do is come up with a way that I can generate some sort of type list at, across a translation unit. So in other words, not all in one place, right? Because concepts, for instance, a random access iterator is in one header. A bidirectional iterator is in another header. How would I know all of the concepts that inherit from the base iterator concept? You don't know at any one given point. You kind of assemble that list as you go along the way. So I had to come up with a way to generate a type list across the translation unit. And I'm not going to go through how this code actually works, but you may be able to figure it out based on this code, but probably not without studying it. The general idea is while you obviously can't modify a type, for instance, a type list, you can insert new overloads to an overload set, right? So the general idea of this approach was I made a way that you can insert a new function overload that refers to all of the previous function overloads. And the most recent overload that you've written acts as a better match when it is being called. So the last one that you called is always the one that gets picked the last one that you wrote is always one that gets called when you that gets picked when you call it with explicit arguments. And that one refers to the previous overload, which refers to the previous overload and the previous overload. And the idea is through that process, you're gradually assembling a type list. And so I use that kind of technique to build up a list of all of the more refined concepts of a given concept. So this is kind of strange, but okay.
So I seem to recall there being a rule that said something about if you would find a different overload in another context under some circumstances, it would cause the behavior would be undefined, and I think this may trigger that case.
Repeat the question.
Oh, sorry. He said that he thinks that this may trigger undefined behavior. Is that right? You said it's undefined in the standard. I mean, what happens, right?
Yeah.
Okay. That may or may not be true. Okay. Well, either way, this seems to work.
I think I might have a strategy for you to do it differently.
Okay. Yeah. So anyway, this is the approach. I'm sure there are other approaches that perhaps don't exhibit undefined behavior. But anyway, so concept refinement seems to be something that can be handled, right? Next thing is a little bit more complicated, and it's type name deduction. So here's an example. This is not in the standard. This is just showing off the problem in a more complicated context. So we have some hypothetical auto concept called hasFind. And associated to the type that's passed in as the argument, there is a key type and a map type and an associated function that takes the original object and an instance of the key type and yields a pair of the key type and the map type. And then I created, some very basic type that should, in theory, model hasFind, and it has an associated function find container comma in. Now, in the standard, this is actually enough for it to realize that hasFind is modeled. And the reason why it's able to deduce map type, even though we didn't explicitly specify what map type is via concept map, because of the return type of find, right? Because it returns a SCD pair of the key type, in this case int, comma float. And so at first I was like, okay, this behavior is kind of complicated. Do I really have to support this, right, for my emulated concepts? And it turns out that you actually do. And the reason why is because this type of behavior is actually exhibited in probably about 90% of the concepts in the concepts header. That is, all of the operations that have, for instance, has dereference, has plus, has unary plus, require automatic, don't require it. I mean, you could obviously write an explicit concept map to specify the result type. But for convenience, you need to automatically deduce result type from the operator if it's present. And this turns out to actually be a huge problem because there are many, for instance, arithmetic-like, inherited from, or refined many different has operations, right? It had has unary plus, has binary plus, has all these other things. And so if I can't automatically deduce the result type, there's not really any explicit way for somebody to provide the nested result type without writing explicit concept maps for each of the less refined concepts. So is that kind of clear? Or are people lost? Or
I was fine up until the very last sentence.
Oh, okay. So which part? So the part where, for instance, arithmetic-like inherits from the previous?
No, I got that it refines all of those other concepts. And mm-hmm. then your conclusion was, and then I...
Oh, sorry. So the conclusion is that, okay, you want to be able to define a explicit concept map for arithmetic-like type, right? And the problem is, it's a refinement of all these other smaller types, of all these other smaller concepts, right? But they all have the exact same associated type name. They're all result type. So the way that you'd have to get around this is, and so that way each operator knows, you can't just explicitly specify some result type in the arithmetic-like concept map, right? Because it could be different for has plus from has unary plus. So getting these to be deduced automatically ends up being really, really important, because otherwise you would have to write explicit concept maps for each of the less refined concepts, which kind of defeats the purpose, because now, especially for arithmetic-like, which has, you know, 20-some-odd less refined concepts, you don't want to have to write explicit concept maps for each of those.
Those are all exactly what auto concepts are for. So.
Right, yeah, of course. Yeah, you don't want to have to explicitly say that you modeled has plus. I mean, that's the whole reason why it's there, or one of the reasons. So I looked up exactly what the rule was for how type names were deduced. And I'm not going to go through and read this entirely. But essentially, the way it works is it uses the same rules that are used in template argument deduction. So for instance, when you call a function with some arbitrary type, and that function is, or some function template, and that function template has some sort of pattern, for instance, std pair, int comma, some other type, then those are the same rules that are used when trying to do deduction on an associated type. So here is what my macro looked like, right? This is the hypothetical macro. And I wanted to see if there was some way that I can do that same type of deduction using template argument deduction with just the information that I have here. I want to convert the information that I have specified in parentheses to something that can be internally represented as metafunction calls or something along those lines, and pull out the map type that's associated with that find function. So these are the different pieces that I can pull out, right, and look at individually. I have the key type, the default value for the key, or default type for the key type, the map type, the textual representation of the return type of find, the name of the function find, and each of the parameter types individually. And so from this, you can exploit template argument deduction and come up with a sort of way to deduce what the map type is. It's kind of complicated, but essentially what you do is you convert the textual representation of the return type and you make it appear in the parameter list of some other function or function template, And for instance, I have class mapped type, which was the map type there. Up here, note that it appears now in the parameter list and also in the return type. And then I call that function with the result of the invocation of find. And from that, I'm able to pull out what the result type of map type was. And just in case find, if find, for instance, didn't actually return a std pair, then this overload would be picked instead. And when I do type def type name deduced result colon colon type, instead of getting the actual deduced result type, I'll get some kind of dummy type, which I can then check against. And so if I receive dummy type, then that means that deduction failed, the concept is not modeled, and I can abort. Otherwise, I have the actual map type. So is that clear, or? it's kind of complicated, but it works, and it's, and.
Is this gonna be on the test?
It's I was proud of this when I came up with this, but I don't know.
Question,
is
this good?
Oh, yep.
So does the dummy type give you information about what failed about the deduction, or?
No, it's just the way that I get the dummy type is, yeah, it just, the deduction, all I know is that find was callable and that the result type did not match the pattern that I was expecting. That's all it kind of tells me. I mean, no further information other than that. Okay. There's also, there are also more rules. For instance, if you remember from the previous slide, where was it? Here there are two functions, right? There are two associated functions, and they each have result type. The other thing is I want to actually, for instance, what happens if this overload returns something different from this overload?
It shouldn't match.
It shouldn't match, right. So it turns out that I have to, inside of my emulated concepts, test each of the associated functions, even if I'm able to deduce it from one. If they all return the same thing, then there's no ambiguity there, and it's a match to the concept. If there is a difference, then I have to abort and say that there is an ambiguous deduction, and I safely handle that situation, so it'll just correctly say there's no match to that concept. So.
Got a hand over there.
Oh,
yep. I don't know how you got map type out of pair.
Okay, so.
You have to repeat for the camera.
Oh, he said, sorry. How did I get map type out of pair? Okay, so the key to that is, so if you remember, I have the textual representation of the return type up there, right? And it includes map type. And that appears in the parameter list of deduce. The reason why I use an identity wrapper is because, in this particular case, it shouldn't matter, but sometimes there are certain qualities. For instance, if it was returning like a, if it specified some kind of type that can't appear directly in a parameter list, or that it couldn't, or that when you call with the result it would be decayed or something differently, or
non-copyable,
some, yes, well, it, not necessarily non-copyable. Actually, the main case is void, right? If it's void, you can't use a type def of void in a parameter list. So that's one of the huge cases. Okay, so getting back on topic. So template class map type. Here's where the key happens. I use the same name of the type that I'm trying to deduce in the template parameter list, right? And so if I call it with the result of find, and find returns std pair of key type and some other type, then when it goes and does the automatic template argument deduction, it associates map type with that, and then I return it in the result type, and then from that I can pull it out of decal type, blah, blah, blah. And that's how I get the result being the map type. So yeah, it's pretty complicated, but it works. So concept-based overloading, what's ironic is concept-based overloading in that first iteration of concepts I showed you was basically the first thing that I got working. And it's all based on the trick that that I showed in concept maps of assembling a type list as you go through a translation unit. And the idea is I generate the tags that you would use with iterator categories automatically in a way that parallels the hierarchy of concepts, right? And so using that auto function macro, what I did was I generate a stub function which automatically examines each of the parameter types, pulls out the associated tag type, and this tag type is actually a type that inherits from all of the other tags that are associated with concepts that this particular type models. And I got that from, again, that type list. And from there, I forward those parameters along to another function call. And now that I have the tag present, I can use tag dispatching underneath the hood. So it's actually two different macros. Unfortunately, my revised version of the library, which uses pseudo-signatures, I have not implemented this yet, but it's coming.
Now, what I'm missing here is the perfect forwarding.
Oh well, this is just showing off what advanced could hypothetically look like in just a standard implementation. I'm not showing the perfect forwarding or anything here.
But it is
perfect forwarding, yeah. Okay. Or quote unquote perfect forwarding. But
it's perfect.
It's imperfect.
It's perfect.
No. So the conclusion is almost, right? So I can kind of do concept-based overloading, but you require some kind of stub function. So it's ultimately just doing tag dispatching underneath the hood. But you know, at the very least, you don't have to come up with these iterator tags or anything like that. And it works with all concepts, obviously, not just iterators. So, going on, I actually defined a bunch of concepts from the standard library and have included a bunch of asserts that you can use with those concepts. Of them, there are 7 or 8 concepts in the OX concept proposal, or last working paper with a minute. And I have all 78 of those implemented. A couple of them, I forget if there are a couple in concepts that I can't technically implement because they require intrinsics, but underneath the hood, I do kind of like a pessimistic thing of just, you know, if I don't know if it's modeled, I just say that it's not modeled. Container concepts, I'm not there yet because the containers are actually really complicated. I don't handle nested member requirements, which are required for many of the container concepts, at least for the legacy container concepts. Iterator concepts, I have all 8 of them made. However, currently, explicit concept mapping to a random access iterator is broken. So that's kind of shitty, but memory concepts, this is the hard part because there's associated templates which require template aliases underneath the hood, which only currently Clang supports, and they just added support for that, I think, 2 weeks ago. I think Doug Greger tossed those in. So I need to start testing on Clang and getting those working. And finally, there's these aren't in a particular header. They're just under concept.support in the standard. And they are things such as same type, I think convertibles in there. Maybe not.
Those are the intrinsic concepts.
Right, they're intrinsic concepts that generally require, some kind of intrinsic support. But for instance, same type, because this is only an emulation of concepts, I don't need all of the special casing that same type needed in the standard. If you're not really familiar with what I mean when I say that, same type actually does aliasing of the types. And it's actually, there's a special casing when you're defining concepts that you actually need special casing for same type. I'm not going to go much further into that. But for instance, template argument deduction, right, requires same type A comma B. That can be used internally to deduce the an associated type if the other part of the same type is already defined. You kind of get what I'm saying there? So that's one example. But also, the other big thing is when generating archetypes, if two types are supposed to be the same, you want in the archetype those types to be the same. If that's clear, yeah. That's another example. Okay. But you I need some way to, when generating the archetype, detect that, okay, these are the same type, rather than having some type that models one concept and another one that models the same concept, but they're not the same type. That's how it tells them that they're actually the same. So it's kind of important, but you know, I mean, I'm only human. So here's the basic header structure for including concepts and for including assert. It's pretty basic. It's the boost generic std concept slash and then the associated header file that's provided by the OX standard prior to concepts being removed. And you can pull them out individually, which is actually kind of necessary because compile times are pretty horrible if you try to just include the entire concept library by itself. And I just have one header for the asserts. It's there. All the concepts, again, are based on NT914.
If I understand right, you think that there are ways to cut the compile down?
Right, okay. So it turns out that, so I'm saying that the compile times are long. I'm compiling on GCC 4.5, and not 4.6 yet, but if I include all of the concepts that I currently have defined, it's taking about 6 seconds to compile a translation unit that includes all of these things. And that's kind of bad. The reason why it's like that is because of all of the preprocessor metaprogramming. And in particular, the thing that causes it is in order to parse these really complicated concepts, I generate an internal representation. I parse the entire concept into an internal representation that's easier for me to do multiple passes over, or to and also to if I find errors in the first pass, I don't partially generate part of the concept. Instead, I get an error, and then the internal representation I can check if there's an error there and not generate any code at all. Sorry, that was kind of convoluted. But anyway, so it's a big long process. I convert to this internal representation. I make a big long pass over that internal representation through a Boost preprocessor fold operation. And the problem is I'm generating so much code behind the scenes in that one fold operation that the state ends up getting gigantic. And so the amount of memory that ends up being eaten is huge. When I first started implementing it, actually, I ran out of address space from just compiling random access iterator, and which is obviously a huge problem. So I optimized it a little bit, so that obviously no longer happens. But it's still very, very memory intensive when you're compiling because of that. But I have there are other advances that I can do to make the compile times come down and to reduce memory usage, so that way they're actually very, very feasible to be used.
Like just pre-processing.
Yeah, pre-processing everything. So for instance, most of the standard concepts, it's not like you're changing those. So you can just run it through Boost Wave or something and generate all of those pre-processed files. And then when you include the header, it just includes that pre-processed header instead. And then Sebastian also gave the suggestion of just, pre-compiled headers. So those are two options. And the other big option is just going through and actually rewriting some of the preprocessor code, so that way I'm not doing such, accumulating such gigantic states. Okay, so here's what the asserts look like. So I have, the main one is Boost Generic Assert, and it should be very intuitive to use. It just, you write the name of the concept and its parameters, and in this case, int pointer is addable with int, so there's no assert triggered. I also have assert not. So we know that you can't add two pointers together, so that there's no assert there. And this last one triggers an assert, Boost Generic Assert, has plus int star. So the idea is we hope that the type of error that I can generate here is very easy to read. Has plus is an auto concept. We want to know exactly why it is that has plus was not modeled. And so this is the type of error message you get. Static assertion failed, requires has plus int star. So that error right there, it says line 14, that I should have numbered the lines here, but that corresponds to this line right here. So the first error you get points directly to the line where the assert is. And the next thing says, in instantiation of has plus associated, or instantiated from here, which points to here, static assertion failed, type name, result type was not explicitly satisfied and cannot be deduced. And if you remember from the examples I showed of has to reference, has plus is very similar. It just has an associated type, result type, and an associated operation of the binary plus operation. And it has to deduce the result type from the associated operation, and that's what this message is telling you. And if you notice, it's pointing to the has plus header. So I'll show an example of this in an actual compiler, but this actually points to the concept definition. So you can actually see as a reference, if you click on it in your IDE, for instance, it'll take you to that header, in particular the macro invocation, so you can see the definition of the concept, and that's where you see the error message. So you actually have a reference, so you know exactly what result type means in that context. Same thing happens here. Don't look at this right here. That 10,691 is the,
the
character column. And if you realize, I mean, has plus is a very simple concept, so if this tells you anything, I've seen error messages where it says like 50,000 here. And that's for, I think, random access iterator. So it generates a lot of code behind the scenes, and you do not ever want to look at the preprocessor output. I've had to look at it much, much too often. Okay. Actually, wait. Before I do this, I'm going to show you an example in the compiler of arithmetic-like, because I think that's a really interesting one. Okay. So here's what arithmetic-like looked like in the last working paper that had concepts, right?
Can you
remember? Oh, yeah. Sorry. Oh, whoops. That didn't work.
The one next to one, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Zapping. Yeah. Good call. I use computers. Okay.
Yeah,
so.
Just what you use them for. The yeah.
Right. Right. Okay. So there we go. Now that's a little bit better. So, concept arithmetic-like again. This is just a refresher. It refines regular, less than comparable, blah, 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 blah. That's what it looks like. So we know what our requirements are. So let's see this in an IDE. Well, actually, I'm not going to show you it yet. I have right here my type, which is just some hypothetical type that I've created that is supposed to model arithmetic-like type, okay? So I'm defining the type. These are just stub declarations. They don't, you know,
and
just to satisfy.
Make that bigger, or
I can try. Whoop.
There we go.
Okay, you can see that, right? Okay, and I didn't show you the syntax for creating a concept map yet, but this is what it looks like. Here it's just empty because I already satisfy these. They can be found via ADL, and all of the associated types should, in theory, be found by the automatic deduction that I detailed earlier. So if I go and compile this, whoops, just this pile, it should work. Sorry if you can't really read this this down here. I don't think I can actually read it. So it compiled fine. It took 4 seconds. Not that great, but whatever. Okay, so let's start looking at some of the error messages we get, right? If we start commenting things out. So do that. Yeah. Comment out all of the relational operators in the constructors. So now what we want to happen is we want to get an error when we're actually making the concept map that tells us, hey, you can't make a concept map because these do not exist. So we do that. We build. And we wait a little bit. Okay, so it looks like a lot of errors, but they're actually very helpful errors. Can people actually read that? I'm sorry, that's really small.
Why don't you just read it to us? Right?
Okay, so it says, static assertion failed. Concept map does not satisfy the following requirements. And it gets cut off, but it actually just says, you know, boost, generic, std concept, arithmetic-like, open angle bracket, my type, and angle bracket. So that's the first error you see, and it brings you to the concept map definition.
Maybe the build block. The
oh, that's
block
a
would not cut it off.
That's a good call.
It can even be.
I can't. I've tried enlarging it. Oh wait, I did. Good call. Okay. So there you can at least read it. Okay, this is kind of. I think the build messages are a little bit easier to read here, unfortunately. Okay, right. I think this is a little easier, maybe. Okay, so the next thing's requires bool operator equals const t, you know, const u. That's the requirement for the equality operator. And if you look at the instantiated froms, that's actually the list of refinements, right? Arithmetic-like refines regular type, which refines equality comparable. And then equality comparable refines has equal to, or has, has equal to, right? So when I click on that line, not only does the static assert tell me what went wrong, it also shows me exactly the concept that it happened in. So we have some context. And similarly, if I look at the other asserts. Notice I have axioms here too. It takes us to the equality comparable, which is where not equals is required. Similarly, for each of the other ones, has less, greater than, less than or equal to, I guess is in the same one. Yeah, it's a requirement of less than comparable.
What do you do with axioms?
Right now, axioms are just ignored, yeah. I'd like to do syntax checking on them at the very least. So the way I do that is just convert it to a function that returns void or something. And there's a little bit more that I'd have to do, because if operator equals is not defined, you're supposed to introduce some hypothetical equals operation. It's how the details in the standard. So you can always use equality inside an axiom. Yeah. So it's a little bit more complicated than just turning it into a function, but yeah.
Do me a favor and make that a really low priority.
Right. Yeah. That's why it's not done yet. I mean, because simply parsing an axiom is very easy, because all I do is I look if the keyword axiom is there, and then something that follows is non-empty and not parenthesized, and I assume that it's correct. Okay. So that's it. And then here's requires. Whoop. You guys are seeing the arithmetic-like definition here. It's kind of big. These are the requirements for has explicit, constructors. It's just referring to these, each of these three errors. And so that's that. So that took, I think I might have to skip through now.
I thought you had another one.
Oh, I might have two open. Yep, okay.
So which compiler was that?
This is GCC 4.5.
That's a good one.
Okay, yeah. So actually getting those, especially the instantiated fronts, that was actually a really hard part. So I'm glad you're appreciating the error messages, because getting things to be instantiated in exactly the places I wanted to in order to get them to refer to the proper locations in the header files was very, very tricky. And not getting any other intermediate things along the way.
Is that very compiler-dependent? Or
The instantiated fronts should not be compiler-dependent, right? Because if they generate instantiated fronts at all.
Yeah.
But the only issue that's big is Clang shows it goes into instantiated from from macro invocations. And since I'm using preprocessor metaprogramming, that's probably going to be huge. But I haven't been testing on Clang. That's something I'm going to have to cross that road when I come to it. But there's also a flag that lets you turn off that feature in Clang. So is that what you're going to say? Or?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So that's one way around it. I mean, it's unfortunate, because if somebody actually wants that feature and they're using this library, they essentially have to turn it off if they want nice error messages.
Well, depends on if you give them pre-processed headers.
Yeah, that's true. And the only other problem is with if you do pre-processed headers, when you get that static assert, you're not going to see that nice macro definition. So that's the only problem with that. That's one of the main reasons why I really want to stress just optimizing my own pre-processing.
It might depend. If you can insert the right line directives in there, then you may be able to pull it into referring to the right place in the code.
You'll have to talk to me later, because I'm not sure exactly what you're saying, but I take it that, okay.
Have you seen pound line?
Yeah, I've seen pound line, but okay. So I didn't, okay. Well, okay. I'll explore that.
No,
I wouldn't be able to generate it from the macro. I'd have to. Yeah.
To do it.
Yep. Okay. So enough already. I want to make my own, right? So here I'm just going to detail the syntax for creating concepts. Okay. So, oh.
Is there a question back?
Yeah.
Try sticking out frag in GCC system header. It should not go into the macros.
Oh, okay. I didn't realize it. Okay. So starting with the basics, something I didn't mention before is I do not handle scoped concepts. And it turns out that the reason why is it's just a really, really hard thing to handle. And especially when I get into concept-based overloading. Because the problem is you have to capture what concept map was at the scope of the first algorithm call, and then you want to pass that concept map along. And that's just too much. I'd have to somehow make it so that way from inside of a constrained template or something, constrained algorithm. Yeah, version 2. It just ends up being too complicated. So I do not support scope concept maps. And what happens is, in order to not do scope concept maps, you have to define all of your concepts at global scope. It doesn't mean that you have to put all of your concepts in global scope. You just have to invoke the macro at global scope. And so I've created this sort of syntax, just namespace followed by your namespaces that you require. So that would be generic nested inside of the Boost namespace. And then here, of course, is the name of the concept and the concept parameter list.
So that closes your namespace?
It opens and closes, yeah.
And then reopens? Is that what you're doing? So
you get a nice little static assert message if you're not at global scope. As soon as it, okay.
Oh.
If you're not at global scope, that's what happens. It'll give you an assert.
Just a suggestion.
Yeah.
Maybe this is crazy, but if to avoid making people go to global,
close out.
You could have it close the existing scope and reopen it.
That's a good idea. Yeah, okay. So he was saying that instead of having it set way, I have to invoke this at global scope, allow it to be invoked at some nested scope, and when the macro is invoked, it looks at how many namespaces there are, closes it out, then it, it does all of the magic and then reopens the namespace, so you're back in there. And the main reason why that would be good is so that way you don't have to have people using the macro to exit out of their scope and go back in when they're done. But yeah.
So that's something that Spirit could use. Fusion could use a lot, because right now a whole bunch of Fusion adapts have to be at global scope,
mm-hmm.
and that makes Fusion code
very yeah.
Where things are defined are not where they're used.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Cool. Oh. Okay. So. Also another thing, this also supports unnamed namespaces, so if you just insert a comma and then nothing else, it's an unnamed namespace. All right, oh, sorry, yeah, I walked through this, I forgot that I had these in here. This is why there are 99 slides, by the way, because a lot of them are just me underlining things. So, yeah, I think it's pretty clear. I didn't mention it before, but the reason why everything, like the parameter, the parameter type has to be encased in parentheses is because I have to have some way at preprocessor time to pull out that keyword type name separate from the actual name of the argument. And the only way to really do that in the preprocessor is to encapsulate it in sort of parentheses.
I don't think that's true.
I mean, if I had commas, it would work, but I have to account for multiple parameters. Well, you said it's not true. Can you expand?
Well, I think the normal trick for detecting keywords
mm-hmm.
is to concatenate.
Right, yeah, and that is actually what I do for most of the library. The reason why you can't do that here is because this doesn't necessarily have to be type name or something. It could actually be a user-defined type def for a value type. I actually do support concepts that have value types, so I can't just simply go through and check if it's type name or whatever, you know?
Okay.
So, yeah, that's it. Okay. So here's identity of. This is how identity of looks in the last working paper that had concepts. It's very basic. It just has an associated type called type, which is equivalent, or actually it's equal to the concept argument. And we require that it's the same type as the argument itself. This is what it looks like in my library. Open up Boost generic auto concept. I'm assuming this is, you know, at global scope, but it's in the library. It's nested in Boost generic std concept. So this is the difference from the previous slide. This concept is auto, matches up with auto concept up there. The name, parameter list, the default definition here. I can't just detect an equals there, so I have to use a comma. But it should look pretty similar. And the requires line looks exactly the same, which is pretty cool. Member function requirements. I do not yet have member type name requirements, but here's how you do member function requirements. All right. Kind of complicated. So I should have highlighted this. You write the. Actually, I should have done associated group or associated function requirements before member function requirements. But
you just said something that confused me. You said you don't have member type name requirements.
Member type name requirements are not. So I do associated types, but not associated type member requirements. So for instance, the legacy. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Cool. It ends up being a little bit more complicated to do that for various reasons. What? Yeah. Those are basically for like the legacy allocator and legacy container type concept. So. So yeah, you put the return type in parentheses. I can't do T colon colon. So anytime you see T colon colon, I use this syntax, this open parentheses, the type in parentheses, and then the name of the associated function. The parameter list, you can just put const, const volatile, whatever, appearing after the parameter list. Here's a constructor. For constructors, you don't write a return type. You just write this T, and then it's immediately followed by the parameter list. For the destructor, you just write this T, destroy. You still have to explicitly write the parameter list. It just has to be empty.
Question?
Yep.
What if I have a member parameter called destroy?
Well, it's actually... He said, what happens if you have a member function called destroy? There's no return type here.
Okay.
So that's how it differentiates. If there were a return type here, then this would work for the member function called destroy. But since there isn't, it knows that you mean the destructor. So you've already seen kind of a sneak peek of this in my example in the compiler. Auto concept has equal to. Here's what it looks like. I'm not sure if I walked through. The key is I can't directly support operator with the actual equals equals token, right? I have to come up with names for each of the individual operators, which I've gone through and done. And it's just a special case for each of them. So you just have to make sure that you know all those names. And here's the big table of names if you're curious.
How do those match the long-running discussion?
I was just going to bring that up. So there's a long-running discussion on the mailing list. I think it's pretty much resolved now, right? Or no? Is it still going? I don't know.
I'm not sure if there's ever been quite a resolution. I think a lot of people just said, all right, this is how I think, and there's no point arguing anymore.
Mm-hmm. I mean, okay.
For the most part, I just said...
Can you focus in on what you're talking about?
Oh, so we're referring to, there's this discussion on the Boost mailing list about the type traits extension, right?
Yeah.
So there's the things that detect if you have all of these things, which is essentially what I'm simulating in my library. And I think... some of the discussion is, for instance, plus assign is one of them. There was some discussion if it should be plus equal, but I used plus assign. I'll explain the rationale for why I chose these names. What was the other one you said?
Unary plus versus negate.
Oh, or unary minus versus negate. Okay, so.
Left shift versus shift left.
Right, left shift versus shift left. All of these different things. And so everybody, it's amazing how much people actually care about this stuff. I mean, it is important that you get a name that's intuitive, that everybody understands. And the way that I came up with these names are actually just based on the OX standard. And so the OX standard had all of these concepts, which were, as I showed earlier, has left shift, has right shift. And so I just... So all I did was I adapted those names and just converted them to, you know, the lowercase underscore lowercase. So all these names are actually just based on the names that were in the standard. And I just figured if I were going to make some
multiplies.
Type of decision.
You didn't use multiplies.
This is, that was one of the discussions? Oh, okay, yeah. Somebody wanted
multiplies.
In
the standard?
Multiplies.
Yeah. For the function object? The one in the
STD. Right. Well, I'm basing these on the concept definitions, so has multiply. So that's why I'm...
I mean, that's where all these things are coming in.
Right. But these, because I'm emulating concept, I used all the names that were used in the concept definitions that were in the last working paper. The only difference is there were no names in the working paper. There were no has arrow, no has arrow dereference, no... they didn't have ones for the allocation. Those are called something different. So I had to just come up with names for those. And so just out of curiosity, everybody knows what, in C++ 03, which of these operators has to be defined as members, right?
Yeah.
Maybe, yeah. So there, yeah, it's just basically, you know, assign, new and delete. You can overload those globally, but if you want to overload them for a specific type, you have to do them as members. The arrow operator, subscript, blah, 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 blah. So there, yeah, address. Oh, wait, no, I don't know if address. I think address of you can do. Non-member, right?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, so addressive is non-member as well.
I think the deal was they wanted to prevent you from overriding these for the built-ins, but then...
That doesn't make... Yeah, I mean, you...
Members plus.
Yeah. So I don't know. And another thing that's interesting is all the compound assign operators, those can be non-members. It's just the actual assign operator has to be a member. Anyway, so there's a similar thing that goes on when defining concepts, except you don't have a choice, right? You actually, when you specify the concept requirements for if something has, for instance, operator plus, you have to specify that one as a non-member, even though you could specify it in O3. When nested inside of a type, you can define that as a member operator. So they have these sort of rules for concepts of which things have to be members and non-members. And unfortunately, it's completely different. Not completely different, but different from what it was in O3. In fact, only the ones that are highlighted right there have to be implemented as members. All the rest of them have to be implemented as non-members. And when I say implemented, I mean they have to be defined that way in the pseudo-signature of the concept. So if you go and you try to implement concepts using the macro, you have to make sure that you define them so that way the appropriate things are non-members or members. I also didn't, so there's these are all the operators. The only one I didn't cover was convertibility. This is what it looks like in the standard. This is what it looks like in my library. You just write explicit, you know, followed by operator and whatever type you're converting to and the parameter list. Again, this is non-member. That's why the conversion operator actually takes a parameter. Here goes back to the automatic deduction. Result type is pulled from that. Again, no difference. I already went over this. Automatically deduces result type. Here's concept value parameters. True is, I think, the only standard concept that uses a non-type concept. Is that, does anybody know any different? Okay. I'm pretty sure it's the only one. And it takes a single bool argument. And the whole concept is, or whole idea is, that when defining another concept, you can put not an arbitrary condition, but, you know, for instance, here I'm using is even, some kind of condition to test and require that V modulus 2 equals 0. This is how I test that concept is even. And if that's the case, then is even is automatically defined for any integer where V modulus 2 is equal to 0.
How do you use this concept?
How do you use this concept?
Yeah.
Wait, can you elaborate? Or I mean, this is how you use true. If that's clear.
I'm not familiar enough with this concept for a person, I guess. So under what condition would this be used?
Well, this is an example use case. I mean, so when you're testing some type of condition,
suppose
that
you have a generic function that takes an array and it needs to have an even number of elements in the array so that it could do some parent thing.
Right. Oh, sorry. I didn't realize you meant that specifically.
So you want to make that concept that asserts that the array length is even. You would use something like this with the. I'm not sure that concepts could take non-type template parameters though.
They can. Yep.
Really?
Yeah, they can take templates too. That concept can take non-type template or non-type template parameters. Yeah, they can take integers, bools, and even templates. You know, it's complicated. I only support values, and they can also be variadic. Variadics are something that I'm working on right now. I have
variadic concepts.
Right now, for instance, I have constructible, which in the standard was a variadic concept. Constructible, it takes the type that you're trying to construct and then a variadic list of all of the argument types. Right now I just provide constructible 0, constructible 1, constructible 2. So they're still usable, but I'm not at the point that I can implement variadics, but I took a lot of care into making it possible to do them. So all the frameworks there, I just have to parse them in the preprocessor. And if you're curious, the way that I'm actually going to parse them is instead of doing dot, 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 I obviously have no way of detecting that in the preprocessor. Instead, I use comma, comma, comma. So it'll be interesting. But I haven't gotten to that point yet, but it should work, and it should look pretty similar, right?
That's pretty cute.
Yeah.
But in the preprocessor, doesn't comma, comma, comma stuff just give you...
Yeah, and that's how I detect it. It gives you separate arguments. So they're encapsulated in parentheses, and then I detect if it's empty and... Yeah. Okay, so this is what it just looks like in my library. I didn't show the concept map, but I'll show that later. Refinement and axioms. We've already kind of seen a sneak peek again. In my example on the compiler, copy constructible is a refinement of move constructible and constructible t, const t, and it has an axiom of copy preservation. Here, as I said, constructible is normally a variadic concept. I can't do that, so I have constructible one. I use public to specify that it's a refinement. I chose public just because it's refinement is akin to inheritance, and we use public when using inheritance most of the time, so it's kind of clear. And you just provide all of your less refined concepts in a list, comma separated, and you just provide an axiom just as you did previously. And as Dave pointed out, the reason why I'm able to accept this perfectly exactly the same syntax is because I don't do anything with the axiom, right? Just kind of ignore it. I look that it's there. So let's look at iterators. This is what it looks like in the standard. And here's what it looks like in my library. There's something that we... actually, I think I'm going through this line by line, actually. Okay, yeah. So iterator and the tuple argument list, or the concept argument list, I should say. We've already seen this before. Similarly, we've seen how to do refinement. Here's something new. So the line up top, move constructible reference, that's just a quick way of saying that it's an associated type name requirement, and reference has to be move constructible. The way I handle that is with similar syntax, except you just wrap the requirement in parentheses. The default, again, is separated by a comma instead of an equals, but everything works. There's post-increment result. The reason why I'm underlining is because, in theory, it should be deduced automatically. So when somebody writes a concept map, they shouldn't have to explicitly specify post-increment result, right, as an associated type. It should be deduced automatically if they have operator post-increment defined. Post increment. So it should be deduced automatically if the person provides a post increment operation. Actually, this is where my deduction breaks down and is what I've been working on for the past, I don't know, couple weeks, trying to get this to work. It's actually, there's a lot more to type name deduction than what I showed in the earlier slides. And it's mostly dependent on the fact that there are type names with certain requirements placed on the type name that you're trying to deduce and other things. I can't really go into all the details, but it essentially makes it that way. It's very difficult for me to deduce what post-increment result is. I wish I could explain it better than that. It's kind of weak, but it ends up being difficult. Requires has reference. We've already seen this, blah, blah. I'll just skip through these. We're running out of time, I think, too. So just to be clear, as I said, I can't get deduction to work on that just yet, but it is coming. But at the moment, the workaround for that is when you specify your concept map for an iterator, you just explicitly specify what the post-increment result is. We don't run into the problems that we had earlier because there's no other associated type in some other refinement that has post-increment result that it conflicts with. So you just explicitly specify it. Okay, I skipped a little bit. Random access iterators, right? Kind of complicated. It ends up being, unfortunately, kind of a mess. First of all, one big difference is, if you notice, you can just refer to value type, right? In random access iterator in the standard version. We can't do that here because value type comes from the bidirectional base. And that's a dependent name in my emulated concepts, obviously. I have no way of getting rid of that. So you have to explicitly specify where the heck that is and that it's a type name. Just as, we've always been used to doing this, so it's not too much of a difference. But it's still kind of an ugly thing. Second thing is, something that I haven't talked about here is, I have a cross out through those defaults. Currently in the library, there's no way to concept map associated or create associated functions from within an explicit concept map. And there are lots of reasons for that, but the main reason is I have no way of injecting those functions into a place that can be found by argument-dependent lookup, right? So if somebody defined somehow, in some hypothetical syntax, how to, or what the associated plus operation was, from with inside the concept map, how would somebody actually refer to that? They'd have to explicitly call it. And there is obviously a syntax for that, I think, in the standard. You know, you just write the name of the concept and all of the parameters, colon, colon, operator, plus. But first of all, I can't do that. And I can't find it by ADL, so that's just a feature that I've kind of left off. I will say, however, though, I do allow for the syntax of defining a default here, even though it doesn't actually do anything. But I parse it, make sure that it makes sense. And the way you do it is the same way you provide a default for types. There's not really one here, but for instance, you just at the end of the pseudo signature, you just put comma and then open brace and the definition. And again, I just ignore it. But at the very least, what that's good for is if I ever get to the point where I'm able to provide a backend that just outputs code that, for instance, concept clang can use, if I have that default there, then at the very least, concept clang can take advantage of that. do you have anything to say there? Looks like you're a little distraught.
No. It seemed like there maybe was a big opportunity for using inheritance of your concept templates, so that if you derive random access iterator of X from bidirectional iterator of X, then you don't need to do that qualification.
Which qualification?
The concept type name bidirectional.
I actually do use inheritance there, but even still, it's a dependent name. So even if I didn't write bidirectional iterator, I'd have to write random access iterator. Cool.
You might look into what I did in the rewrite of the Boost concept check library that makes that less painful.
Okay, I'm unfamiliar with exactly what you're referring to, but we can talk afterwards, I guess, and take a look at that. So yeah, he was just, sorry, I didn't repeat the question. He was just pointing out that, yeah, there may be a way to get rid of that whole type name bidirectional iterator thing.
One way to do it is to just have a self type so you can just say type name.
I actually did include a self type, and I forget the reason why I couldn't use it. But yeah, I do define like self type in terms of random access iterator, and that's there in the implementation, but there was some kind of problem with it. But it seems simple enough, but... Oh, I remember what it is. The problem is I have to define self-type. The places I'm doing the static asserts, the self-type cannot be visible for some reason. But I may be able to change that. It might have just been too complicated for me to implement at the time. But the places that I do all the metafunction checks and where the static assert, they all have to be aware of what self-type is. And it means passing along the name self-type to different things. Okay, sorry, but yeah, it just ends up being sort of complicated. Creating concept maps, I think I only have a couple slides for this because ultimately I can only provide associated types. Everything else is picked up automatically. I have an empty slide here. Everything else is picked up by ADL. All the associated functions are just ADL. So here's what a concept map looks like for pointers, non-constant pointers in the standard. Here's the first problem. Here's one problem. I can't do yet constrained concept maps. So in the standard, it's constrained that T is an object type. So for instance, we do not want a void pointer to be matched here. That's the big case. Unfortunately, I can't do that yet. But underneath the hood, I would have to use the same technique that would be usable for concept-based overloading, and just implicitly take the concept maps that are associated with it, and then when the map is looked up, use the tag types to deduce if it can be if it's associated with this concept map or not.
You can use with template specializations.
Yeah, I know. Actually, that's pretty much everything is used with template specialization. I don't actually use the function form. That was just kind of an example at the beginning. The only time I use function form is when doing type deduction. Okay, so there's a huge future direction. I really wanted to get archetype generation in before BoostCon. It turns out it's pretty complicated, but I'm hoping that I'll get that done in a month or so. Other things, improve preprocessor error detection. Currently, it explicitly explodes in a horrible mess if you screw up the way that you're passing parameters to the macro. And I've been taking care to make it so that way that's not the case. I have ways internally of detecting the errors nicely. I just don't really act on them, and so you still just get a mess. But that should be somewhat easy to change. I have no documentation other than basically these slides at this point, and also all of the definitions that are in the headers. Now that Clang started supporting a lot of the OX features, I can actually start getting this up and running on Clang, so I need to start doing that. I haven't mentioned Microsoft Visual C++. I'm actually running Windows, which is why I'm currently just using, I'm only using 4.5. I don't think there's a way to get 4.6 running very easily on Windows, but I can't get this running in MSVC 10 yet because their preprocessor is so non-compliant that I have to basically create an entire new, I have to probably end up duplicating the entire code base in terms of hacks. And right now it's something like 30,000 lines of preprocessor macros. So it's a huge task. At the very least though, I could actually start testing on MSVC if I just take the preprocessor route, which is preprocessed files, and then I could start testing in that sense. But the preprocessor part is a big task. I need to add type template requirements. So as Dave was pointing out, he wasn't sure. They actually are supported. So you can do template concept parameters. No, that's not even what I was talking about. I'm actually talking here about rebind and allocator. So allocator has an associated template rebind, which I can't handle yet. As I said, Clang is the only thing that would be able to support that because they just recently got template aliases, which is how you satisfy those constraints. I need to parse variadic concepts, which again, I'm using comma, comma, comma. Allow ref qualifiers on member function requirements. This is something I actually didn't even know about until I read the standard, which is ref qualifiers. Does anybody know what they are? I mean, I'm sure Dave does.
I think you mean like R value reference this parameter.
Yeah, I think that's how people refer to it. But yeah, it's just after the CV qualifiers on the member function, you can actually put either an ampersand or two ampersands or nothing at all. And that specifies how the this pointer is bound, right? Yeah. So I don't have any support for that yet, but that's something that's a little ways off. I'm trying to think I don't know if there are any concepts in the standard that actually use that feature with concept requirements, so it may not be that important. Then I want to finish implementing all the concepts that were in the standard. Do basic syntax checking on axioms, optimize the preprocessing. I'm probably going to be doing that along the way. Make a backend targeting concept Clang and concept GCC, even though concept GCC is pretty much dead. This is actually a really, really easy thing to get accomplished. And as you've seen in all of my static asserts, I basically already do the transformation that's necessary to get it into the syntax. So that should not be hard at all. In fact, I may do this very, very soon and just start using concept Clang to do some testing and see how that goes. Depends on which I find more interesting, I guess. Then finally, get Boost Generic reviewed and hopefully into Boost. And finally, create concepts. I would like to create all the concepts for different Boost libraries and have them actually use this library. So that's pretty much it.